lecture recital this evening. So just a couple things before you get started. If you have your phone, please turn it off. No flash photography, please. So off, silent, all the things, make sure it doesn't go off. And after Mya sings, there's going to be a very, very, very brief moment just for us to reset the stage for her when she comes out for her lecture, so don't go anywhere. When that happens, it's going to be very brief. And without further ado, everyone, please welcome Mya to the stage.
Thank you.
Thank you.
try. Okay, great. Thank you all for attending my lecture recital tonight. I am very happy to be presenting my research that I have done this semester. So, how does culture impact the perception of liturgical music? Tonight I will be analyzing three genres: the Roman Catholic Mass, the Requiem, and Oratorio. Specifically, I chose to analyze Johann Sebastian Bach and his Mass in B minor, George Friedrich Handel and his Oratorio, Messiah, Maurice Duruflé and his Requiem, and Michael Tippet and his Oratorio, A Child of Our Time. For lack of ambiguity in the context of my lecture, I want to distinguish between liturgical music and sacred music. Liturgical music was any music intended for use in worship setting, particularly a worship setting that utilizes liturgical texts and traditions. This term does not necessarily have to be used in a Christian context only, but rather can be used to apply to any worship setting. However, for the purposes of my presentation this evening, I will be using it solely in a Christian context. The Mass would be an example of a liturgical setting. Sacred music is music that was composed with engagement to biblical themes or ideas. Oratorio would be an example of this, usually being based off of biblical themes. However, oratorios can be composed without being deemed as sacred music. The first composer and work that I will be looking at tonight is Johann Sebastian Bach and his Mass in B minor. The structure of a Roman Catholic Mass originates out of tradition in liturgy. The Mass text was originally utilized for normal services. Bach was a Lutheran, not a Catholic, so he had written Lutheran versions of the text deriving from the Catholic Church, but he had never written a full-length Roman Catholic Mass before. On page 4 in your handout, figure 1 shows when Bach completely finished each part of the Mass, writing the first half for a job interview at St. Thomas Church in Leipzig, Germany in 1723. He used this opportunity to demonstrate his skill in incorporating German, French, and Italian styles into one big work. The Mass in B minor was probably never written as a concert Mass, meant for performance rather than church service. The music historian George Stauffer describes how the St. Thomas Church requested Bach to compose the Mass in a style that suited the taste of the Leipzig community. Bach did not generally care about his music being well perceived in the community because he was not wanting to conform to the popular styles of the 1700s. The public would have preferred Bach to be writing in a more operatic style, like Handel, but he purposely chose to stick with a strong counterpoint style that is very characteristic to him. In the book, The Learned Musician by Christoph Wolff, Wolff makes it very clear how parody writing was an integral part of Bach's writing in the Mass. Parody writing means that Bach composed a lot of the Mass by taking older compositions of his and adapting it to the musical and textual contexts of the new work. In 1733, Bach finished the middle two parts of the Mass for a music competition in Germany. For the sake of posterity, Bach revisited the first two parts of the Mass that he had already written and added the last portion of the Mass to create a fully completed Roman Catholic Mass by 1748. Within the context of the Mass in B minor, there's little evidence of performance and perception of the Mass. Adding on to that, music historians do know that Bach's writing style was not well perceived during his lifetime. Music historians such as Stauffer and Wolff have pointed out that Bach intended his music for posterity rather than immediate fame. He developed his own musical language that he was unwilling to change to fit the public opinion. So what does this mean for culture impacting how his work was perceived? Well, although we don't know much about how it was perceived in the 1700s, Bach's intention for posterity did play out. In the 1800s, the Mass was revived and has been one of Bach's most beloved works ever since. Bach might never have intended the Mass in B minor to be performed within the church or within a concert hall, yet it is still one of his most popular works to this day. This is due to Bach's unwillingness to conform to what the public liked in the 1700s and working towards success in posterity. Moving on to a more sacred genre of music, oratorios originated out of Italian opera in the 1600s. The expense of producing an opera continued to grow and production companies started to lose money. Composers got creative and started composing oratorios. However, influence for the oratorio genre also emerged out of sacred texts put to musical settings, such as liturgical dramas, dating back to the Middle Ages. In comparison to opera, oratorios are similar regarding the musical style, chorus, solos, and story plot lines. They are different because oratorios do not include staging, costumes, acting, or characters. Due to a fewer number of resources needed, oratorios made a much larger profit for composers and production companies. The oratorio genre originated as sacred music, incorporating biblical stories and themes as the plotline. However, oratorios were labeled as a genre by their structure, not by their plotline content, so secular oratorios are common as well. On page 4 of your handout, figure 2 gives a brief timeline of George Friedrich Handel and his oratorio, The Messiah, which was composed in 1741. For the context of The Messiah, this oratorio would be a sacred oratorio, being based off of a biblical theme. The Messiah quickly became one of the most beloved oratorios to the state. Handel was equally a composer as he was a businessman in the musical field. The musicologist Donald Burroughs describes how Handel was always one step ahead of his other composers, always predicting the next big entertainment market to become popular in society. This applied to every genre of music that he was composing, not just oratorios. Regarding his success with oratorios, however, Handel was one of the first composers in England to introduce the genre to the public, becoming very popular early on. Ticket prices for oratorios were much less than opera tickets, making them much more accessible to a middle-class audience as well. The sacred plot lines in oratorios also appealed to the Christian-based society that England had back then. Handel premiered the performance of The Messiah in Dublin, and when the oratorio came to England, its success grew to an even greater degree. As just mentioned, the Messiah premiered in Dublin and became an instant success. The Dublin Journal published an article the day after it premiered in 1741 saying, quote, "Yesterday, Mr. Handel's new grand sacred oratorio called The Messiah was rehearsed to a most grand, polite, and crowded audience, and was performed so well that it gave universal satisfaction to all present, and was allowed by the greatest judges to be the finest composition of music that was ever heard," end quote. After its immediate approval in Dublin, Handel soon showed it off in London, where it became one of the most popular entertainment attractions and philanthropic fundraiser events. One specific example that the performance of The Messiah fundraised for was the Foundling Hospital Chapel in London. This was a children's orphanage and hospital. After raising and donating the money to the hospital for the chapel, Handel was assigned to dedicate it with one of his works. For its dedication in 1757, Handel utilized The Messiah, being a perfect pick for this event since it was The Messiah that raised the money in the first place. Oratorios were never meant for church services, but meant to entertain the public, be more affordable for the middle class, and appealing in a vernacular language. Handel was able to understand that entertainment needed to reach wider audiences, and he successfully did so through his oratorios, and specifically The Messiah. In the picture, you can see a full orchestra and choir performing this work exactly how it was intended to do so. Handel's music was successful for a variety of reasons, but mainly, Handel was a public figure and very large one by the 1740s. He was working for the royal family in London and had many other high-class patrons at this time. His genius in the business side of music was able to provide him towards a path of success in that regard. The Messiah was probably perceived so well because his fame was already there. However, this work is arguably more popular today than it was back then. And obviously, Handel is not around anymore. So, the work on its own is very well perceived alongside its grand reputation. Moving on to a very devoted church musician, Maurice Duruflé was a French composer who spent his entire life in France during the 1900s. His Requiem, written in 1947, is one of his most well-perceived works within the realm of church musicians and within the realm of secular musicians. Requiems, like the Mass, originated out of the Roman Catholic Church. The text is derived from funeral service liturgy and normal service liturgy. There are concert requiems that composers have written for concert hall performances, such as the Brahms Requiem, which is sacred but not liturgical. However, for this context, Duruflé's Requiem is strictly a liturgical work. The Requiem, along with a lot of other his works, utilized Gregorian chant as a driving influence for the compositional structure of his work. On page 4 of your handout, figure 3, you can see how Duruflé spent 5 years at the ruined cathedral choir school. During his time there, he was under strict discipline that created him into being a very quiet Catholic boy that kept to himself and did as he was told. This character carried over into his professional life for the rest of his career. Paris in the mid-1900s was vibrant and exotic and experimental and edgy. As a devoted Roman Catholic, Duruflé may have felt left out of place in the Paris society. He only fully published 14 pieces during his lifetime. This was due to his immaculate attention to details and wanting to consistently perfect everything he created. James Frazier, a 21st century church musician and scholar himself, describes the inwardly focused nature of Duruflé in his book, Maurice Duruflé, The Man and His Music. Frazier talks about Duruflé's intense interest with Gregorian chant. Duruflé studied Gregorian chant very intensely in hopes of bringing back the tradition of chant into the realm of modern 20th century church music. But above all, for Duruflé, all of his compositional practice was aimed towards his faithful dedication to God, creating each piece of music he wrote with a strong foundation of worship. The Requiem was inspired by the end of World War II and the end of his father's life. Duruflé wanted the work to signify hope beyond life and death. For this reason, he did not include the Dies Irae movement, the movement about the wrath of God, which is known to include harsh music. The implementation of Gregorian chant was Duruflé's main defining feature as a composer. In traditional chant, free meter was utilized, and the melodic lines were grouped in small sections of twos and threes. To better portray this style, Duruflé constantly changes the metrical pulsing of the text to match the similar qualities of traditional Gregorian chant. Another feature of Gregorian chant was modality. Today, music is crafted around tonality. Everybody has heard of C major, right? Back in the medieval period, keys and tonality did not exist. They used modality. On page 5 of your handout, you can see a chart that shows the different modes and keys utilized in the Requiem. The key centers with major and minor are the typical tonalities utilized in 20th century music. The key centers with hypolydian, Dorian, Phrygian, etc. are the key centers that are specific to Gregorian chant modes. Free meter and modality are, again, utilized by Duruflé to pull tradition back into the modern church of 20th century. In the picture, you can see a boys' chorus singing in robes and a pastor in the pulpit next to them, signifying a church service. It seems this is how Duruflé intended his work to be presented. His Requiem has also been seen in performance venues that have nothing to do with the church. Duruflé was and is not the most well-known 20th century composer outside of church music. However, his Requiem is very well-known and utilized in the classical canon of the 20th century. The public really loved his work in a church setting and in concert settings. Duruflé's avoidance of modern modernist techniques such as harsh rhythms, constantly changing harmony, and the incorporation of novel sounds was a purposeful choice to avoid what composers were around him were doing to be different. Duruflé did not want to be different. He wanted to glorify God through his writing, and he saw romantic impressionistic techniques such as statically moving harmony and fluid melody lines as the way to achieve this. In 2006, the San Francisco Choral Society published an article called Maurice Duruflé, A Man Out of Step with His Times. They said that since his writing style was more like that of the Romantic period, he was giving himself a disadvantage as a composer for not going along with modernism. I think that's an unfair perception of who Duruflé is and how it represents his music. He spent his entire life dedicated to church work and meant his music to be for the worship of God, not for public approval. And with that, people inside and outside of the church still loved his music. Taking a hard turn away from church musicians, Michael Tippet is the last composer that I will be looking at. On page 5 of your handout, there's a timeline of Tippet in the production of the oratorio, A Child of Our Time, written in 1941. This oratorio is an example of a secular oratorio. Tippet does not include sacred themes in this work, but he also includes many other secular themes as well. Tippett's writing style in this oratorio and throughout all of his music matched that of modernism. Tippet was an artist devoted to capturing the human condition, or the good and evil, within society. He was very interested in the role of music in society and how his music could influence society just the same. Tippet was not a religious man and meant his music to be performed in concerts, to make a political statement rather than a religious proclamation. His oratorio, A Child of Our Time, is a classic example of Tippet utilizing musical composition to describe the human condition. The work was composed during World War II, holding a plot line of a little boy's life who would eventually be killed by Nazis. This was a topic that people could emotionally relate to, giving the oratorio mass appeal during this time. Arnold Whittle, a music journalist, wrote about the different musical styles Tippet utilized within the oratorio to represent oppression beyond Nazi regime. On page 6 of your handout, you will see that Tippet integrated 5 traditional African-American spirituals into the whole work. All of the text for the oratorio, besides those 5 movements, was written by Tippet himself. He chose to incorporate those spirituals to further his theme of oppression within the oratorio. This is important because Tippet was trying to pull direct references from dark times in history, only adding to the public appeal of this work. Looking at the screen, I have put here a very small excerpt from the movement of the work that I just sang. Look at the first measure and notice that the piano does not play at the start of the measure, but waits until the offbeat. Then 2 bars later, the voice part comes in on the downbeat and continues to come in on the downbeat for the next 2 measures after this. Through my own analysis, I have concluded that the syncopated relationship between the voice part and the piano part creates an unsettling feeling that helps evoke the dark nature of the poetry that is presented in this piece, of which you can read in your program on page 3. Along with syncopation, Tippet includes other devices that help evoke the dark poetry in the work, such as stark dynamic contrasts and a wide range of dissonant harmony. The public really loved this oratorio. The picture here shows how it was meant for a big performance. Oliver Sodden, an author who takes a large interest in Tippet, gives a little bit more context for the actual intent behind this work in his article, Tippet and Eliot. Originally, Tippet wanted A Child of Our Time to be an opera, but Sodden explores written correspondence between Tippet and T.S. Eliot, where the two artists talk about the intended purpose behind the work. Sodden reveals how after careful discussion, T.S. Eliot advised Tippet away from making it an opera, in fear of distracting audience members from dramatic staging. So, Tippet went with an oratorio, which presented the work as a concert for people to sit and absorb the emotional thematic material. A child of our time has persisted to be Tippett's most beloved work to this day. A quote written by the Hollywood Bowl commentator David Coplin suggests that its success is due to its, quote, universal themes, straightforward language, and often traditional musical material, end quote. The impact of this oratorio had on the public was quite drastic. People wanted to feel the hurt of World War II through his music, showing how a secular form of an originally sacred genre can be perceived in a society where Christianity is more of a civic acceptance rather than an act of faith. Now that I've gone through four different composers and a specific work of theirs, I want to point out why this information matters. Throughout history, music has been used to identify or sway public opinion. Musical propaganda is an example of this. The changes in musical styles throughout the eras of history are also an example of this. Public opinion of music matters, and vice versa. The impact of music can make an opinion matter as well. Without understanding why or how music is important to people, music has little value. Bach created a personal style that the public did not like, but played out through posterity. Handel's business tactics led him to be the most successful composer in London society at this time, composing well-perceived music throughout his entire career because of it. Duruflé wanted to pull the traditions of Catholic Church back into play by putting Gregorian chant to Impressionism, being a technique that people of all social types fell in love with. Tippett mixed musical styles of music into one large work to appray the human condition, a technique that allowed people to really connect with the themes within. Out of these four composers, Duruflé was the only one with a true intent of liturgical worship. It seems that the other three utilized the structure of mass and oratorio as a structural musical form that best suited their needs. Despite the intent and success of each given composer, all four of these works were received well by public opinion, showing how liturgical and sacred works are perceived in different contexts. I hope you have all learned something from my presentation and enjoyed being my audience tonight. I will now be accepting questions if anybody would like to ask anything. So please raise your hand and I will try my best to answer. Yes, John.
Looking at figure four in the finality and reality.
Yes. Intent behind not using modality, because Gregorian chant is pretty present throughout the whole work, so he probably chose to stick with one key. However, we can look further into that. Do you think, what do you think? Do you think there's a specific reason, or you're just asking?
Just asking questions.
Yeah. Anybody else? Question? Yes.
When those were first composed, were they played with the organ or symphony orchestra accompanying the choir?
Which one? All of them?
Well, yeah, I'd be interested in.
Yeah. So Bach, starting with him, when it was first composed, it wasn't performed really. It was very on the back runner. But it's supposed to be, it's orchestrated with an orchestra. People play it on, like I played it on piano, so it can be played if resources are not available on organ, piano, or a lesser amount of instruments, but it was originally orchestrated with a full orchestra. For Handel, that was also originally for a full orchestra, however, for different circumstances, I played it on piano, so you can limit the amount of orchestration used. Duruflé actually published three different versions of his Requiem, one for organ and just the singers, one for strings, organ, and the singers, and one for full orchestra and the singers. So there was lots of options there. And Tippet was for a full orchestra as well. And during the 1900s, resources were much more available in that sense for performance. So, yeah. Anybody else? Yes, in the back.
Did you choose the first two because they were more classical? I noticed they were about the same. So you wanted an example of sacred and oratorio between Bach and Handel, and then between Duruflé and Tippet as more modern examples of sacred and oratorio? Or I'm just curious how you chose your pieces.
Yeah. Do you mean the genre of, or the, yeah, the genre of music or the pieces that I sang specifically?
Well,
or the time period?
The pieces you sang were illustrating your concepts of sacred and
oratorio,
and the two, they both seem to be pairs based on the time period in which they were composed. And I'm just wondering if you chose them to be like more classical versus modern examples of your sacred versus oratorio, or if you just chose them because you like to sing those pieces, because you did a beautiful job.
Well, thank you. Well, we picked the pieces before I picked the topic, which that's, I picked with my voice teacher, Dr. Shan, based on my voice type. And so I'm kind of limited in that way. I can't do any solo from any work. I have to do alto solos in that regard. But I did purposefully choose two older works versus two newer works to kind of look at context differences. So it's more modern, more relevant, something that we can understand and relate to, and also an older context in that realm. Does that kind of answer the question?
Could I follow up on that? Do you think that modern music, as far as popular music of the time periods, as far as popular music today, could you see a similarity in the way that, for example, the rise of Christian popular music with the sacred versus maybe an example of oratorio sort of in popular culture today in the music of today?
So I don't quite understand what you're asking.
I'm not sure I do either.
Okay. Let me try, can I articulate back maybe what you are asking? Yeah, are you asking like if oratorio could become as popular as maybe pop Christian music now?
Well, I'm just wondering if we consider oratorio as more of the popular music.
Oh, I see.
It doesn't have to be sacred, right?
Yeah, so this is all classical music. Back then, classical music, I think, was taken a little bit differently. However, even back then, big concert hall performances were not what everybody went to see. There were still people that would play music on the streets, kind of like today, and people would have house music as well. So that, I would say oratorio, it's very similar, whereas now there is concert music, which is kind of what I would perform. I wouldn't sing this in my house for fun. my parents are like, no, please. Not my sisters, though. Okay. But Christian pop music, some people do play in their house or in their car. I play this classical music in my car, but more people do not. So it's kind of different in that realm. Does that answer your question a little
sort of,
bit?
Yeah. I don't know what I was asking.
Yeah, okay. Yes.
Maya, thank you very much for your presentation. It was beautiful. I learned things that I didn't know before.
Cool.
I was impressed first by your expertise and your execution of that. It was a great gift to me and to your entire audience here. Second by your learning, and it's obvious as you give us your presentation and your notes and in your discussion with us. But
because of the cello part, because I love cello. I try to play cello, and I like play an orchestra, but I'm not that good. But I love cello, so that's my favorite piece. I think, yeah, that's my favorite piece. Baroque music is not my favorite, so that just kind of eliminates, even though I like those pieces and I enjoy singing it, those are not my favorite at all. The Tippet piece is very interesting, and working with modern rhythm has been a struggle for me, but it's really nice to kind of enter that realm of, it's like a dipping my toe in chromaticism and weird rhythms, so it's cool because of that, but it's not melodic and free and emotional, which is kind of what the Pia Jesu is, and I really love it because of that. So, yeah.
Thank
you. Yeah. Yes, over here.
So, you mentioned that Duruflé did not have many of his pieces published, at least not during his lifetime. The ones that were published, do you know what kinds of works they generally tended to be, or were they for certain instruments?
He published, I don't want to say all, but I want to say all his music for the church. It was very church music centered. I don't want to say all because I don't know if all of it was for church, but everything that he did compose was very sacred in that sense, or liturgical. I don't know about orchestration. I know he did do a lot of organ stuff, but I'm not sure about the other things. No. Yeah.
For the five spirituals in A Child of Our Time, did Tippet use pre-existing melodies with the words, or did he write his own musical material, or did he at least reference the existing melodies?
I am not sure. I think he used the melodic material as well, because why would he be implementing them? Because he wanted people to hear it and recognize where it was coming from. So it was to draw awareness that oppression is not just within Nazi regime, it's not just within Jewish culture, it's throughout everybody. It was kind of a worldwide, I want everybody to be called to listen to this and feel something. So those were specifically implemented to signify slavery and stuff like that. So I'm sure the melodic material was in there as well. Yes.
First of all, beautiful recital and great presentation.
Thank
great. So this is kind of a two-parter question.
Mm-hmm.
First question is, do you see a difference between worship and performance? Second question is, for a performer, for instance, like a beautiful recital, and to performing this faith-based music, do you see that as worship or performance, or do you see it as both somehow?
Yeah, well, I guess that's a very loaded question. So, so, repeat the first one for me. Is there a difference between worship and performance?
Yes.
Okay, I think yes. And kind of to relate that to something that everybody knows, maybe pop worship music, some people take as a performance and some people take as a worship setting, right? It's the same kind of thing where I think it's just contextual. So like for me, the meaning of it is, or for some of it, the Duruflé, he meant his music to be in a worshipful setting, but I'm performing it in a lecture recital. Does that make sense? So this music can be performed outside of its realm, just like anything can be performed outside of its original intended purpose. But what it was originally performed for, the Duruflé was worship, Bach probably not, it was just like performance and for posterity reasons. Handel for performance, although people use it, you hear the, what is it, Hallelujah chorus every Christmas now, so people use it in church settings, I think it's bad to go to church and think, these people are just performing on stage for me right now. Like, you want to be invested in the music for yourself, so that's almost a personal mindset, too, of how you want to perceive it. Yeah, there's so many different ways I can go with that. But what was the second question?
as a performer, like in a sort of performance set, mm-hmm. since you just sang these faith-based pieces in a recital, do you see it, like for yourself, I guess, as worship, or do you see it as performance, or do you see it both?
I see both. Because when performing, you have to know where it comes from, and you have to know what you're saying. So I need to know what I need to evoke to my audience to understand what I'm trying to portray. I don't want it to be purely a worship setting, though, because I am not in a worship setting. So it is a recital in that regard, and it's me up on stage with a pianist performing, but the content is still the content. So I'm not gonna sing Tippet and say like I'm worshiping up here, because it's not. It's talking about gods and secularism things. But if I'm singing Pia Jesu, the thought in my head does go, okay, I'm going to portray maybe a more worshipful, like God kind of look to me, and then think. And it's a little bit different as a performer, I think. But with working with Dr. Shan one time with the Pia Jesu, she said, like, actually emote the words, and it helped me sing it better. So there's two different sides taking it in, which is understand what you're saying and portray that, and then also you're performing, so it has to sound good. So, yeah. Does that answer the question?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
So you just mentioned that the Tippet was sort of more secular than the other works. Do you think that he used the sacred text that was in the piece solely as just sort of a mass appeal type thing? Or do you think that he used the text because he liked the meaning behind it, even if he wasn't necessarily religious?
So within the text, there's different religions even pointed at in the work. So it's not just Christianity, it's Judaism. Paganism, I think, is even in there. So there's different religions in there. I think he probably implemented it in there to kind of bring awareness that it's a whole body person. It's not just one group that it's referencing. It's an entire people group. And we don't care if you're this or that. We're all just going to be one and come together during this horrible time when the Nazis were kind of doing really bad things. So I think it was an intentional purpose of implementation to appeal to everybody, honestly, and try to show that it's not just about one group. It's about everyone. Does that answer?
Yeah, that's good.
Okay. If it's not good, I can...
Do you think he like carefully selected the works that he was using, or the
yeah.
text that he was using?
Yeah. Okay. Oh well.
Or do you think
besides
he just,
the besides? Sorry. Go ahead.
Sorry. No, I was wondering. If he just, it's okay. If he just sort of thought this text will appeal to Christians, and then
yeah.
this text will appeal to Jewish people and all those things.
So he actually wrote all of the texts.
Okay.
Besides the African American spirituals, he wanted T.S. Eliot to write it, and he told him no, because the music was so emotional and dark in that way that T.S. Eliot said, this is your brain going on in this music, and you need to put text to it. So he wrote it all himself. It wasn't him picking texts. So I think he was trying to maybe match what his music was making him feel and say, okay, this is kind of the theme I want here, this is kind of the theme I want here. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah? Good? Okay. Cool. All right, anybody else? Any questions? No? Okay. Before we go, I want to say a couple of thank yous. The first one is to Dr. Mueller in the back. He has advised me and worked with me for multiple hours this semester in his office, telling me, go revise, all semester long. And it has been the biggest help for this project. I would not have been able to do any of it without him. And I learned so much, not just this content on the screen and stuff, I learned how to put this whole thing together because of him. So big thank you to Dr. Mueller. A big thank you to Dr. Shan, who is my voice teacher and has patiently worked with me on developing my voice this semester. I've had some vocal issues and I'm almost over them, so that's great, and I'm so thankful for her. Dr. Shin, thank you for being a great, great accompanist for me and putting up with me. And a little thank you to my two performers, Timmy and Katrina. I'm very grateful. All right, good night, everybody. Thank you.